Lord, we just thank you, for it is a privilege to be with you. The greatest privilege we can know is to be in your presence, to feel your love, to know you. So, Lord, give us the hunger, give us the thirst for your righteousness. Cause our hearts to turn. Let our hearts melt within us, that we would be eager to hear your word, eager to obey, run in obedience to what you would have us to do. Enable us. Cause us to turn, Lord, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Today I want to talk about Yom Kippur, and as a, I guess, introduction to that, I want to springboard on what Jonathan Kahn sort of laid out yesterday, and I'm still a little bit in shock over it. Because it's not until you see the series of things that have been done and understand the prophetic significance of it, and then also the relation back, whether it's the harbinger, we will rebuild, or what's currently happening in terms of the Shemitah years and the blood moons, you know, you kind of want to say, where's the bomb shelter, and do I have enough dry goods to make it through? And how do you maintain being salt and light? How do you do that in the middle of a wicked and perverse generation? How do you maintain your joy? How do you maintain your witness? And as I was praying through it, that, you know, has our culture eroded so far that we don't even realize it, and we don't realize our absolute need to return, and how, as Christians, should we act now, and what should we be doing? And it came to me that the real thing that we needed to be doing is paying attention to the Jewish calendar, which needs to be understood as, well, it's our calendar too. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you believe that he observed all of these festivals. These are the appointed times with God, where God meets with his people. He's the one that set it up. So it's not the Jewish calendar, it's God's calendar. And he's the one that laid it out. And coming up on God's calendar, Tuesday night, is Yom Kippur. Do we have the slides? I don't know if you, there you go, okay, great. Just keep them up, and nobody really cares what I look like. Especially me. I look in the mirror these days and go, wow, I'm getting old. But Tuesday, September 22nd through Wednesday, September 20th, and maybe that's just pride. Maybe I'm just confessing. I need to be humbled. Age will do that to you. Tuesday, September 22nd at evening is the beginning of Yom Kippur. So we're in the Shemitah. That is now, technically, I think as of today, is done. And then the blood moon is this weekend, the final one. And then you have Yom Kippur on Tuesday night. So what should we do? Jay wants to say something.
Blood moon is on
28th. 28th. Oh, so it's after it. Okay, so it's the weekend after. Okay. All right. So in this calendar, the Day of Atonement is upon us, and are we treating it properly? Are we understanding it as a church? We may have a lot of understanding, obviously have misunderstanding of the blood moons, and we may have understanding of the Shemitah. We may have understanding of what it means to dwell in tabernacles. We may have all of that, but are we treating Yom Kippur as the high holy day that it is? In God's calendar, it is the holiest day of the year. And so if you're responding to what Jonathan Kahn said yesterday, what do we do? How do we bring a nation back? And I think more importantly, how do we as a people of God, the church of God, bring the church back? Because it seems to me we're being more influenced by our culture than we are influencing our culture. How much have the ways of the world come into our worship, and what do we think about, and what are the meditations of our hearts? What are our dreams and aspirations? Do we truly hold to the standard that our dream, our hope, is to dwell in His house forever? There's huge significance to David saying that, that the only thing he wanted was to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. But when you look at church attendance in America today, we don't seem to want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We're slow to go and real quick to leave. And that's only if we're doing it. And if you look at the surveys, only a third of Christians in America today are going to church regularly. So are our hearts right? And as we look at Yom Kippur, are we looking properly? Have we gotten so used to the grace of God and the forgiveness of God that we have forgotten the severity of God? And that He is not mocked. And He's certainly not going to be mocked by what is being done in America today. But in our own hearts, are we looking at what are we doing and how are we responding? So today I want to get into what is the Jewish observance of Yom Kippur. And then these days of awe leading up to that are days of examination. That we examine ourselves and our conduct and our hearts to see what is coming out of them. And there's this prayer that they pray, and I'll talk about it. It's the Vidui prayer. And if you ever want to feel guilty, break out the Vidui prayer and start walking through the detail of it and the heart examination that results from it. I'm not going to do the complete one today because it's in Hebrew. It's every single letter of the Hebrew alphabet begins a prayer. So we would be here a long time. And I remember one of the things about invitations back is you got to be short. So I will encourage you, and we will have maybe in chapel resources, Joel can get a couple. There are more than one. There are variances depending on the tradition you're from, but when you examine yourself in light of the Vidui prayer, do you hit a biblical standard? And I went through one last night and came to the firm conclusion that I needed to be right with God, that I needed this time of self-examination. Where is my heart? What is my heart reaction to things? And the beauty of the Vidui prayer is that when it's prayed in the synagogue, with each prayer, the right hand goes to the heart and pounds and says, it's from my heart these things come from. These aren't external. It is from my heart. This is where my sin begins, and I need to change my heart. Remember the cry of Stephen, circumcise your hearts. Let your heart be tender before the Lord. Let the Holy Spirit come in and examine where are the hard places and how have those hard places come? Is it because you're carrying offense? Has somebody wounded you? Has somebody trespassed against you? Are you carrying that? That leads to hardness of heart. That leads to woundedness. That leads to breaking of fellowship with God Almighty. That needs to be cleansed. That needs to be healed. And the wonderful news is we as Christians get to do that and get to do that literally every day of the year and every moment of every day of the year. You can come to Him and get forgiveness. Let's go to the next slide. This is where Yom Kippur comes from. It's from this wonderful chapter in Leviticus. On that day, the priest shall make atonement for you to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. This is a big deal. This is where the blood comes into the Holy of Holies and is put on the mercy seat. And that whole Hebrew word to cleanse you, if we can get the next slide, you get into what is the, next slide. There we go. Kafar, where you cover, you atone. And I love the other meaning, pacify. That the things that the word of the testimony in the Ark of the Covenant, the tablets of the Ten Commandments are testifying against Israel, you pacify that. And it's the blood sprinkling happening. Now, when we pray from the New Testament, we go boldly to the throne of grace. We're going here. We're going to that mercy seat. We're going to that covering, which has been sprinkled with the blood of the sacrifice. This, in Old Testament times, and what Leviticus is describing, is but a type and shadow of what Jesus did, where with his own blood, he sprinkled the mercy seat in heaven as a covering, as an atonement, as a pacification of the word of testimony against us. So in our examination, let us remember the mercy seat. The longer I walk with the Lord, the less I ask for justice and I ask for mercy. You know, have mercy on me, a sinner. And when Jesus described the two versions of prayer in the temple, one was from a Pharisee, one from a tax collector. The tax collector, keep him in mind, he's beating his breast. He is praying a Yom Kippur prayer. He is praying a vidui. And he's saying, have mercy on me, a sinner. Who walked away justified? Not the Pharisee, but the one who said, have mercy. Let's get the next one. Unless our righteousness, your righteousness, my righteousness, exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. This is not a seeker-friendly verse. Okay? This isn't one where you have easy grace. This is one, are you right with God? And it's a very heavy verse. These aren't my words. These are the words of Jesus. These are the words of the ones we come to and ask for mercy. And he says to all of us that unless our righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, we will not enter the kingdom of heaven. I don't know about you, but I've tried to live Torah observant just as an experiment. And I'm not trying to get anyone under, you know, legalism or under that bondage. I want to stand fast in the freedom where he has made us free. I want that. But at the same time, that does not excuse the meditations of my heart. It doesn't. And I've got to recognize that. And is my heart right before him? Is my heart inspired by the Holy Spirit? Or am I far from him? Is he far from me in my thoughts? In order to get the righteousness that exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees and scribes, you have to have Jesus active in your life. It can't be a Sunday morning thing. It has to be a continual, is his indwelling presence in you? Is it motivating you? Is it motivating what you do? Are you loving him? And are you loving your neighbor? Those are the standards. And so often I find in my life, I don't. Let's get to the next one. Hosea is a prophet that's sort of rarely studied. A lot of it has to do with how difficult his life was, where he's a prophet of God, and he prophesies in the same time period as Isaiah. So Babylon has not invaded. He does prophesy of that. He also prophesies of the invasion of Assyria. but he was during the kingdom prophesying to Judah, saying, you have to return to God. And God gives him a very difficult prophetic ministry where he is commanded in a prophetic act to marry a prostitute and have children with her. And those children, he is not sure are his. That's hard, isn't it? And the last one, you know, as a prophetic act, the last one, God tells him, call his name Lo Ami, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. And it's an illustration for all of Judah that you have so strayed from the Lord that you can no longer be my people. Based on what we heard yesterday, if you were God Almighty, would you still consider America one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all? Would you still want to acknowledge, you know, look at America, it's the city on a hill, it's a shining light to the nations, it's an example of what happens when a people say the Lord is their God. The unfortunate thing for America is that we don't have a prophecy that we can come back to the land. When these judgments come, there's no corresponding that if we return, he'll restore. We don't have that. We have, as a people, we don't have that promise. We have covenants that our forefathers made. But I tremble in thinking that God Almighty will start to reject us as a people if we do not turn. The good news is that we can still turn. We haven't been driven out of the land. We haven't been divided. We can still come back, but now the issue is, will we do that? Let's get the next slide. In Hosea's time, the prophecy over Judah was, I will return again to my place. So that means God will leave the sanctuary. And the rabbis say the Shekinah, the glory of the Lord, was departing from the temple during this time period. So the glory recedes. I will return to heaven, to my place, till they acknowledge their offense. Then they will seek my face. In their affliction, they will earnestly seek me. For the Jews in this prophecy, that didn't happen until Daniel did it in Babylon. For us today, can it happen now? Do we really need to go through yet another horror? Do we need another 9/11? Do we need another Katrina? Do we need some disaster of that magnitude to get us to finally seek his face? I remember the weeks following 9/11, and it was very curious going to church because suddenly all the parking lots were full. I mean, we were having traffic jams on Sunday morning. And then it faded away. Then it evaporated like the morning dew. Our repentance evaporated. In the Hebrew behind till they acknowledge their offense means that you absolutely own your own guilt and your own participation in it and your own heart motivation. This isn't some Alford plea. I'll be a lawyer for a moment. In law, if you're a criminal defendant, there's a way that you can stop a prosecution by what's called entering an Alford plea, where you say the prosecution has plenty of evidence, but I'm innocent, but I'm going to plead guilty anyway. And so often in our confession and our repentance and our turning back to God, are we entering an Alford plea? Are we saying, I know that's wrong and I shouldn't have done it, but it's not a big deal? You don't understand the circumstances. And what God is looking for is absolute acknowledgement of our guilt and ownership of it. Have mercy on me, a sinner. That we understand this isn't some circumstance thing, that these things came out of our hearts and out of our mouths and out of our motivation. And we own it. And we say, I did that. And I repent of that. And I never want to do that again. Let's go to the next one. This is a happy sermon, isn't it? Everybody's like full of joy. Right after he says that, I love the next chapter. Come and let us return to the Lord, for he is torn, but he will heal. He is stricken, but he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up that we may live in his sight. Let us know, let us pursue the knowledge of God. His going forth is established as the morning. He will come to us like the rain, like the latter and former rain to the earth. And this is a prophecy of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. This is a prophecy of the law, the Torah being written in our hearts. This is a prophecy that we will live in his sight. His countenance will be lifted up on us. His face will shine upon us. That Aaronic blessing will happen not on an intermittent basis, but on a constant basis. This is a prophecy of a Messiah who will be raised on the third day. This is a wonderful thing for us, and we get to live in it. But if anyone has walked with the Lord for any period of time, you know that your heart wanders. You know that you are prone to do that, that you are moments of on fire, and then moments where it's my time now. And I get to do certain things, and I get to live my dream, and I get to do these other things. And have we so pursued those gods of convenience and pleasure and the American dream that we have forgotten the God of our forefathers? Have we left their dream? And their dream was there would be a land where you could have freedom of conscience. There would be a land where we were free to worship the Lord our God and to do that regularly and dedicate our lives to that. Have we gotten so far away from that we don't even recognize it anymore? Let's go to the next one. This is the Vidui prayer. This is one form of it. The ownership of this is what I really love. As you prepare for Yom Kippur, keep this prayer in mind, and keep that how much it shows a heart that wants to turn to the Lord. Our God and God of our fathers, may our prayers come before you, and do not turn away from our supplication, for we are not so impudent and obdurate as to declare before you, Lord our God and God of our fathers, that we are righteous and have not sinned. Indeed, we and our fathers have sinned. Now that's a confession. The next one. We have transgressed. We have acted perfidiously. We have robbed. We have slandered. We have acted perversely and wickedly. We have willfully sinned. We have done violence. We have imputed falsely, we have given evil counsel, we have lied, we have scoffed, we have rebelled, we have provoked, we have been disobedient, we have committed iniquity, we have wantonly transgressed, we have oppressed, we have been obstinate, we have committed evil, we have acted perniciously, we have acted abominably, we have gone astray, and we have led others astray. There are other versions of this that get into a much longer list, as if that were not enough. But one that really struck me as I was reading through it last night is how much it pertains to my conduct as a father. And have I properly transmitted the law of God to my children? And in their observance of me, are they seeing a Christian? And this prayer gets into that kind of detail, where are you in your walk, and are you the living example that you want to be? Is that an aspiration for you, or is it just something you aspire to but don't ever think you can attain? And in that abandonment of your own standards, are you also confessing that God is not able to do that for you? And I would submit he is able to the degree I am willing. And I just have to set my heart to him and understand if I want to live in his sight, then there cannot be these secret things. There has to be straight up and down, I'm walking with him. Let's go to the next one. We have strayed from your good precepts and ordinances, and it has not profited us. Indeed, you are just in all that has come upon us, for you have acted truthfully, and it is we who have acted wickedly. You know, you heard the end of Jonathan Cahn's talk yesterday, where he talked about pharaohs wanting to kill them, and there are no more pharaohs. Assyrians wanted to kill them, and there are no more Assyrians. Babylon, the prophecy has come true. It's desolate. It's a place for owls. You look at the various things that have arisen in Europe, Russia, all to persecute. Those are still there, but the Jew lives. And every one of them is praying this: you are just in all that has come upon us, for you have acted truthfully, and it is we who have acted wickedly. When you read Deuteronomy and you read the curses, you understand how prophetic they are and how every one of them has been fulfilled in the Jewish people over the past 3,000 years. And yet they still pray, you have acted truthfully. Start thinking about your own life when you've gotten warnings from God, no, don't do this. I'm grateful for those warnings. I'm not so grateful of the times that I've disobeyed those warnings and said, this isn't a big deal. And then when bad things start to happen and things start to fall apart, am I really ready to receive the judgment of God? The old saying, when it happens to me, it's a test. When it happens to somebody else, it's judgment. Sometimes it's not a test. Sometimes you are reaping what you have sowed. And are you humble enough to acknowledge before a righteous and holy God, I am reaping what I sowed, and I am sorry, I turn from that, and I turn to you. I want your grace, your mercy in my life, but I don't want to presume upon it. I want to be righteous in my thoughts, righteous in my words, righteous in my actions before you. I need you to do that. I need you in me, writing your words on my heart so I do not stray from you. Let's go to the next one. Hosea ends, O Israel, return to the Lord your God, because you have stumbled because of your iniquity. Take words with you, which is a curious phrase, take words with you. The Hebrew behind that is take devar with you. Take the prophecies of God with you and return to the Lord. Say to him, take away all iniquity, receive us graciously, for we will offer the sacrifices of our lips. A lot of prophecy within this. And Thank God they took it to heart, and when they were exiled to Babylon, they made sure they took the scrolls with them. And this enabled Daniel to understand the prophecy of Jeremiah. He had that scroll with him. He understood the 70 weeks that Jeremiah prophesied were fulfilled, and he repented for the entire nation. It's a wonderful prayer, and it's a long one, so I'm not gonna pray it. But I encourage you to read it. If you're interceding, if you, like me, are burdened for America today, I'm burdened for myself, I'm burdened for the church, but I'm burdened for America. How do you pray for a nation to return? You find it in Daniel chapter 9. And it begins as a prayer of personal confession. He doesn't separate himself from the sin of Israel. Here is Daniel, the beloved of God, the one who is perfect, the one who said, I will not eat Babylonian food. Let me eat the food ordained by the Torah. Let me live righteously. He is a prophet. He is a seer. He sees the future, and yet he humbles himself and says, I've sinned. I and my fathers and my people have sinned. And we need that in America today. We need to put away the pointing of the finger and start saying, where are the ones who will stand in the gap and say, Lord, have mercy on your people? Remember the prayer of Moses, where God said to him, let me wipe them out and I'll make of you a great nation. And he says, no, don't do this. No, no. Remember, don't let the Egyptians say that you brought them all this way just to kill them. For America, can we say, we're a nation of immigrants. We've all come from other places. Don't let them say we were all brought here just so we could be wiped out. Can we stand in the gap and say, Lord, have mercy on us? We are sinners. We have gone away from your precepts. We have set up idols. We have worshiped false things. We have worshiped an American dream, which is an illusion. We haven't followed after you. We haven't recognized that you're the source of all our freedom, all our prosperity, everything we have. You're the source of it all. We need to take the prophecies with us into our prayer closet and intercede, just as Daniel did, to say, have mercy. Let's go to the next one. The end of Hosea is then echoed in Hebrews, where what is the sacrifice? What is it that God is looking for us to do? At Yom Kippur, it was a multitude of sacrifices that led to a final one that blood was then sprinkled on the mercy seat. Jesus has done all of that for us. So for us, what is the sacrifice that God is looking for? Well, he's looking for the fruit of our lips. We do that in praise and worship, and I hope you give thanks to the Lord. But I want to take it to another level and go to the next slide to realize everything that we say is important. And within our tongues, we have the power to curse, we have the power to bless, we have the power to give life, we have the power to give death. And Jesus was very specific about what causes defilement, what causes us to get out of the grace of God and get away from his face shining upon us. And it's those things which proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile a man. It's what you express. Start thinking about what do you express. Do you express hope and joy and righteousness and peace, or anxiety, worry, complaining? What is it? And recognize those things come out of your heart. When you get far enough away from God, what is then coming out of your heart is a continual stream of blasphemy. And I've been around that, where you look at them and go, how did you, do you know English? is there another word? Can you get a dictionary and get some other words? But it's more than that. It's evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, theft, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man. And they all come out of the heart. And it's then when the heart gives presence to it by you speaking it. And again, that vitui prayer, it's from our heart that these things come. This is where it proceeds from. If our hearts are right before the Lord, we don't have to worry about these things because it's not going to come out. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit and you're in His presence and His face is shining upon you, you are not going to have evil thoughts. The good news is we get to dwell in that. We don't have to leave that temple. That temple is in our hearts. His throne is there. We don't have to worry about it. But this is where it comes from. And on the next one, next slide, you'll see that there are very eternal consequences to this. It's by the words, your words, you will be justified, and by your words, you will be condemned. This is an idol. This is something very serious. And when this verse first came to me in my prayer closet about 20 years ago, I was like, oh my goodness, I repent. Please change what I say. Please change. You don't want to hear on that day a tape of the things that you said. You don't want that coming back and echoing in your ears. It is going to be by the words of your own mouth that you're judged. And that we need to change. Let's get to the next one. When David sinned, it's a great psalm he wrote. We all know his sin with Bathsheba. Bathsheba gets a lot of the press. Uriah doesn't get too much press, but Uriah was one of his companions in battle. Uriah had been with him in the caves when David was not king. He had suffered with him, and David saw fit to murder him. So there was a betrayal. There was a breaking of trust and covenant and friendship. There was a lot to it. And there was more than just he slept with his wife. There was a deep sin. And David says, "Has mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin." And the next slide, he says, "Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." He was asking not just for forgiveness, not just for cleansing. What he was asking for is, from this point forward, may I be steadfast. May I have that steadfast. I'm going to seek you, seek the knowledge of you. May I be steadfast in my spirit. Let's go to the next one. This is another Psalm of David. We don't know when this one was written, but it's one I would encourage you to adopt. And it's the close of it. And adopt specifically in this time of Yom Kippur, this time of atonement, these days of awe where we're examining ourselves, our hearts, and say, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." And let us underline "my redeemer." None of us are righteous. All of us have sinned. All of us have fallen short. The good news is that Jesus paid the price. But are we willing to pay the price as well to say these? Let our words be acceptable. Let us, what I think about, what I meditate, what comes out of my heart, may it be acceptable in your sight. Amen? Happy Yom Kippur. I know that was a heavy message, but last night in the aftermath of what Jonathan had delivered, I went home with fear and trembling. What will it take? What should we do now? It's not let's just go out and look and see the blood moon. Let us go into our prayer closet. Let us examine our hearts. And let us make sure the blood of Christ is there covering all of our sin. It's not a blood moon we need to look at. We need to look at what is in us. And are we living steadfastly before Him? We have some prayer requests. This is our week of prayer. This one comes from Baton Rouge. I am asking God to send me a godly man as a husband. I have breast cancer. It's in the lymph nodes. It's also in my lower back. Please pray for me and my family. Pray for healing for my husband Vic and our son Victor, who has MS. And pray for us as well that we would have a financial blessing. My prayer is to have a relationship with my daughter, health and strength, and help paying off my mortgage. Please pray that my elderly parents, Lewis and Charlotte, will believe in their hearts that Jesus is Lord. Let's just lift these to the Lord. Lord, we come to you. And we come boldly to the throne of grace. We come to that mercy seat sprinkled with your blood. Not in our own righteousness do we come, but we come clothed in the righteousness that you have so freely provided. And Lord, we ask for that steadfast spirit. We ask that our hearts would be cleansed, that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight. Give us your holiness, your purity. Let us think with your mind, feel with your heart, and let our words be anointed by your Holy Spirit. And now for these requests, we lift them to you, and we ask for healing. We ask for provision. We ask for relationships to be restored. And Lord, we lift America to you and we stand in the gap. Have mercy. Turn our hearts. Let your spirit cover us again. Let the knowledge of you cover America as the waters cover the sea. And let us turn from our iniquity. All the false gods we put up against you. All the blasphemies. Lord, forgive us and set us free so that we can come and worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, do it, for we ask it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you.